Go ahead and we'll get there, but go ahead and turn in your Bible to 1 John chapter 2. How about 1 John chapter 2 and Matthew chapter 7? 1 John chapter 2 and Matthew chapter 7. As you know, I've been going through these series on the art of brotherly war, and I've been just hitting on different subjects, really, and tying it all into one overarching theme. And the subject I'm going to hit on today is the subject of forgiveness and what the Bible actually says about it. And, you know, in my opinion, I think there's a lot of misunderstanding with this particular subject. And I'll explain to you this morning why I think that is, and we'll look at these scriptures and hopefully dispel some false understandings that maybe some Christians have, and maybe you've just kind of adopted over the years through osmosis. But these lessons have a lot to do with judging just judgment. And justice, you know, justice is a good thing. You know, the idea is, well, you don't have any rights. You know, if you're a Christian, you don't have any rights. You're bought and paid for slave. Well, yes, that's true. Before God, you don't have any rights before God. You're not going to, you know, necessarily have a right before God for anything. I mean, what do you deserve? However, before men, you do have certain rights. Between men, absolutely, but not before God. But justice, you know, is a good thing. Justice has to do with judgment. And God's a God of justice. God's a God of judgment. He loves justice and judgment. And it's in accordance with the nature of God himself as far as justice goes. Now, when I say justice, let me just point out that I'm talking about true justice, not the modern liberal social justice that they talk about, where you and everyone else in society have to be punished by someone else for something that someone else did to someone else over 100 years ago. That is not justice. As anyone who will take the time to actually look at the facts knows, the modern BLM movement is nothing more than a communist movement pretending to be social justice movement, and unfortunately there's a lot of suckers in our society who have fallen been tricked by it. And I don't apologize for one second for saying that. And true justice, on the other hand, is a good thing and should be desired, you know, for your country, for your church, and for your life, and for your individual situations. But there's a strange, perverted view of justice among Christians these days. And for many years now, Christians have had a strange, perverted view of judging and judgment in general. And this has inevitably led to a strange, perverted view of justice in general. And modern Christians love the verse, "Judge not lest ye be judged," right? I mean, that's like the life verse of modern Christianity. And I don't doubt that 90% of the Christians who quote that verse, you know, they've got it memorized on the tip of their tongue. I don't doubt that 90% of those people, I'm just throwing out a random statistic, but 90% couldn't find that verse in the Bible if their life depended on it. And they have no idea what the context of that verse even is, and are probably unaware that there's other verses in the Bible, such as 1 Corinthians 2:15 that says, "He that is spiritual judgeth all things." And they probably don't care enough to try and figure out why the apparent discrepancy. All right. Now, we've looked into that verse in the past, and I don't want to take the time right now to dive deep into Matthew chapter 7. But the bottom line is, in that chapter where it says, you know, "Judge not lest you be judged," Jesus is not saying that you cannot and should not ever judge. He's not saying that. He's simply telling you not to be a hypocrite when you do judge. All right. Matthew chapter 7, verse 5 says, "Thou hypocrite, first cast out the beam out of thine own eye, and then shalt thou see clearly to cast out the mote out of thy brother's eye." What is so hard to understand about that? He didn't say, "Don't ever think about casting the beam out of thy brother's eye." He didn't say that. He said, no, first deal with yourself, then deal with your brother. He didn't say you can't deal with your brother because that's being a hypocrite. No, it's just there's an order here. Just don't be a hypocrite when you're judging, that's all. And it's really not that hard to figure out, unless you're doing something wrong and you don't want anyone to tell you that you're wrong for doing it. Then you can just ignore the rest of the context and just quote verse 1. But because the whole concept of judging is so messed up among Christians these days, it's not surprising to find out that the whole concept of justice is messed up too. And justice is almost considered a bad thing in Christian circles these days. And you know, if you want something to be rectified, you know, often you're accused of being bitter or having a bad attitude, you know. And truthfully, let me ask you this. Truthfully, as a Christian, what recourse does an abused Christian have these days in the modern church setup? I mean, in our legal system, if you get hurt by somebody else, you have recourse in that you can go through the legal system and get proper restitution, right? Or you can appeal to a judge and say, hey, this is my case, this is my cause, and this is what this person did, and I think I deserve some retribution, or I deserve this thing to be fixed. And there's nothing wrong with doing that. That is called justice. You're not wrong for appealing for those type of things. But in the modern Christian church society context, if you will, what recourse does an abused Christian have? If a Christian is transgressed against by another Christian, you know what counsel they're normally given? I bet you could all probably say it. You just need to forgive that person. That's usually the answer. Okay? Somebody breaks into your house, you know, steals your stuff, drives off with your car. The judge says, you just need to forgive that person. You know, you get your kid gets a vaccine and he ends up dying or becomes autistic from it or paraplegic. You just need to forgive Pfizer. You know, that's what the vaccine industries would have you to believe. You just need to forgive us. Right? You just need to forgive that person. You see, the only recourse a Christian has is to forgive or else be condemned for being bitter and unforgiving. Now, I know that sounds good and positive. Well, just forgive, okay? That sounds good and positive maybe to someone who hasn't been abused. And when it comes to minor infractions, that might be good advice. I'm not going to say that's bad advice with little things, okay? And I'll get into it. But the problem comes when no one has any other answer than simply just forgive. Every situation falls into that category. You just have to forget. And the problem comes when this answer is made out to be some kind of higher road. And the problem comes in when this answer is taught as the Bible answer. Now, I told you at the beginning of this series, I'm going to explain some things and show you some things that maybe you've never heard before. And this lesson today and the lesson next week is going to be one of those lessons. I'm going to show you something that I almost am positive that most of the people listening to the sound of my voice have never heard this before. And it's something that I think you need to hear, okay? And but for the record, the Bible says, despise not prophesying, but prove all things. Hold fast that which is good. Just because I'm up here with the Bible saying this stuff doesn't mean that I'm right about everything, okay? You need to listen. You need to hear and say, well, what does the Bible say about that? I don't know if I agree with that or not. Okay, prove all things, you know? Don't just take my word for it, you know? So I'll give you something to prove this morning, all right? The fact of the matter is, when it comes to this idea of, well, just forgive, okay, that really starts to fall apart in matters of big transgressions. For example, I was in a church service years ago. I think I've used this illustration before, but I heard a Christian evangelist, and he was actually a lawyer, you know, of all things, and he gives this illustration about a woman, you know, whose two sons were murdered by a criminal. I remember this so vividly because it's like the dumbest illustration I've ever heard. But it was years ago. Her two sons were murdered by a criminal. And when the trial came, she stood up in front of the judge and said that, Judge, I forgive that criminal. You know, the judge was about to throw the book at this guy. And the woman stands up and says, Judge, I forgive him. I forgive him. You know, and it's supposed to be a real tearjerker, you know, it's like a build up to this story, and then, you know, that's the climax, you know, she forgives, you know, and it's supposed to be a tearjerker, an example of how everyone should be, and everybody come to the altar, you know, type of thing. But hold on a minute. So if a guy murders my family, Jesus Christ wants me to forgive that person. Is that what we're saying? Is it? That's what he was preaching. Let me ask you something. If a guy murders my family, does Jesus Christ forgive him? That's an interesting question. If a guy comes, breaks into my house, and kills my family, has Jesus Christ forgiven him? So this is where you're going to have to start to think. What would you think if a guy went out and murdered someone's family, and then at the trial, the judge said, Sir, I forgive you. Now, don't you think that victim would be devastated by that ruling? I mean, how would the victim feel, right? And then seeing the victim, you know, is visibly disturbed by the ruling, the judge looks over at him and says, hey, you need to forgive that guy too and quit being so bitter. Right? Right? And yet, I don't know if anybody takes the time to stop and actually think about this stuff, because this is how it's generally preached. Okay? What kind of God-forsaken justice would that be? Right? In a courtroom. That would not fly. Right? In your very soul, you know that would be wrong. You know it. Right? And yet, that's precisely what's being taught and a lot of times believed by Christians these days. The judge forgives, and so I have to forgive, no matter what it is. Because that's what Christians do, I guess. Right? Now, I know what you're thinking, and we'll get to that. Don't worry. All right? So, what about this? A man cheats on his wife, the whole family's in chaos, and the wife is told she just needs to forgive him and move on and accept him back in the family because Jesus has forgiven him. Right? You know, when he died on Calvary. You just have to forgive him. You know, what are the... what? So you say, no, that sounds ridiculous. I know. But why is that preached? Where's the recourse? Right? Is there a recourse? What does the Bible say about these things in the context of the New Testament? We're just supposed to forgive and forget and love people, right? Now, you can always love your enemies and do good to them that hate you, all right? And we've gone through that. But what about this forgive and forget thing? What does the Bible actually say about forgiveness? These are the prevailing ideas these days, and since everyone thinks everyone is already forgiven for everything, therefore, you need to forgive everyone else for everything too, is kind of the idea. And I have a news flash for you, but that is absolutely incorrect, okay? And I'll explain that to you this morning. And in order to understand the basics of forgiveness, it would help to go back to Calvary and understand the basics of Calvary, okay? Now remember this, God is a God of judgment and justice, and sin must be punished. Not because God is a jerk, but because God is just. And sin must be punished. And the first writing that he ever gave to mankind, at least to a people, he wrote with his very own finger, and it was the Ten Commandments. Okay? That was a set of laws from a lawgiver that pertained to legality. Do you understand? Okay? The Ten Commandments are the cornerstone of justice, if you will. And specifically, the nine moral commandments. One of them is a ceremonial commandment to the Jews. You know, I guess God tithed one commandment to the Jews. You know, one commandment's for them. But mankind has always had those nine commandments, the nine moral commandments written on his heart. And just for good measure, God wrote them in stone in 1450 BC. Every man on the planet has broken God's law. And consequently, in order for God to be just, okay, he must punish man for breaking his laws, the punishment being death and ultimately hell, right? Okay, we would all agree with that. During the Old Testament, God had a setup where sinners could make certain atonement for their sins by the sacrifice of animals. But that was just a band-aid, so to speak, and only covered their sin. It didn't take away their sin because the payment of an animal for a man is not an equal payment. Okay? An animal is not the equivalent of a man. And so an animal's death couldn't pay man's full penalty. Do you understand? It's very simple. When you're looking at it from the standpoint of a legal context, that makes perfect sense. For the law to be satisfied, an equal payment has to be made. And a man's here and an animal's here. It's not the same. You can't, it has to be an equal payment. If my sin was to be fully paid for, I would need another man to die for me. It would have to be a man, okay? A human being, because I'm a human being. But a sinful man who is already condemned cannot pay my penalty. He can't pay my debt to God when he himself is in debt to God, right? That was the problem. But because God is also a compassionate, loving, merciful God, he didn't want his creation to burn in hell forever because he had made hell for the devil and his angels, not for his human beings that he had created. All right, so God devised a solution. Since a sinless man is what is required to pay sinful man's debt, God decided that he himself would become a sinless man and die for the sins of men. He would pay their debt, right? And that's just what he did through Jesus. That debt was paid, right? That debt was paid. Hallelujah. All right? At Calvary. So then why do we need to preach the gospel to anybody? Let me ask you that question. Why does it matter what anyone believes? The debt was paid. If Jesus paid for everyone's sin, then isn't everyone debt-free and forgiven? Well, if they're forgiven, they need not fear the judgment. God can't send someone to hell for sins that are forgiven. That's not justice. That's called double jeopardy, and that's illegal. Double jeopardy is the prosecution of a person twice for the same offense. Okay? That'd be like Jesus prosecuted and you prosecuted. That would be like this. If you owed a massive debt and you were about to be thrown in jail and serve a life sentence, and at the last minute you were told that someone paid your debt, and the judge slams the gavel and says, "You're forgiven, the debt is paid." Woo! You know? Oh, wonderful, that's amazing. You know, and then you go off and you live your life, and 20 years later, you're arrested and hauled into jail or hauled into court, and you're condemned for not paying that debt 20 years ago. You know, say, "Well, hold on. What? You can't just arrest me for a debt that you guys told me it was paid for. You guys told me it was forgiven. You, as the judge, even ruled that I was forgiven and my debt was paid." And the judge says, "Well, yeah, but you now have to pay your debt, so too bad." What? You know, as anyone knows, that'd be a perversion of justice. You can't do that. If it's forgiven, it's forgiven. You see? The judge would be as just as corrupt as the sinner if that's how things worked. But that's not how things work in the Bible. Don't worry. This book is a perfectly balanced book. This book is perfectly legal. And the judge of all the earth will always do right. And it will always balance out. All right? The scales of justice always balance out with God. And Jesus' death on the cross was for every man in that he died on the behalf of all men. Turn to 1 John chapter 2. This is important because there are some people that would say, "Oh, well, Jesus only died for the elect, and that's how we solve this problem." You see? But that's not true. 1 John chapter 2, verse 2. It says, "And he is the propitiation." Propitiation is just a big word that means the act of appeasing wrath and conciliating the favor of an offended person. Okay, so Jesus is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of all the elect. No, but also for the sins of the whole world. Yes. Every single person, thank God. Turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. The Calvinistic teaching that salvation, Jesus only died for the elect, is unscriptural, completely wrong. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, in verse 14. It says, "For the love of Christ constraineth us, because we thus judge that if one died for all," A-L-L, "then we're all dead, and that he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again." Turn to Hebrews chapter 2. Hebrews chapter 2. One more. Hebrews chapter 2. I'm just showing you what the Bible says here. Who cares what Calvin thinks? And frankly, who cares what I think? What does the Bible say? Hebrews chapter 2, verse 9. "But we see Jesus, who is made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man." Okay? All right, now we're going to have to think about this a little bit. Jesus' death on the cross was for man's sin, right? Jesus' death on the cross was for all man's sin, right? Everybody's sin when he died on the cross was for everyone. Okay. He died for everyone. So therefore, everyone is forgiven, right? Okay, that's, I know, it's causing the wheels in your brain to think, well, he died for everyone, so then wouldn't, if he paid the price, wouldn't that mean that everyone's forgiven? Okay, how does these things work? All right, now, sometimes, especially in evangelical churches that don't believe the Bible usually anyway, when these things are not thought through and sometimes recklessly preached, okay, the result is unsaved people naturally get the impression that they're okay with God. You see, Jesus paid for everyone's sins so that they could be forgiven and saved. Jesus died and paid for my sins so that I could be forgiven. Therefore, my sins are already paid for and I'm already forgiven. And I didn't even know. I've been saved my whole life. You know, right? You go up to say to someone, you give them a tract, sir, are you saved? Oh yeah, I'm already saved. I've been saved my whole life. Haven't you heard that? Well, why do people think that? It's not because they're stupid. It's because a lot of times that's what they've been told from the pulpits. Jesus died for your sins. He paid for the sins of the whole world. That's the good news. You're all forgiven. You're all children of God in Christ Jesus. Hold on. Look at Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5. And it is almost logical, because if Jesus died for everyone's sins and paid the debt for everyone's sins, which he did, it says there, then that would mean that everyone's debts are forgiven. They're paid. Done. Well, there's an asterisk in there. There's some fine print. You know? Look at Romans chapter 5, verse 18. Okay, so look at this. Therefore, as by the offense of one, that'd be Adam, judgment came upon all men to condemnation, right? And you're born with a sin nature thanks to Adam, okay? All right, well, look at this. Even so, by the righteousness of one, that'd be Jesus, the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life. Uh-oh. Well, you were born in sin, right? Because of Adam. Amen. Well, Jesus died on the cross, and even so, isn't this saying that the free gift came upon all men and the justification of life? So everybody's saved then, right? Is that how that works? Every person born since Calvary is born saved, I guess. Is that what that verse is saying? All right? Well, it says the free gift came upon all men under the justification of life. What are you going to do with that? So I guess we don't even need to preach the gospel since everyone is saved, right? Not quite. Now look at the key is in the preceding verse. All right. Now I remember Dr. Ruckman saying I could get up in the pulpit one night and preach salvation by works, and then I could get up in the pulpit the next night and from the Bible preach salvation by grace, and then I could get up in the pulpit the next night and say baptism saves, and then I could get in the pulpit the next night and preach that baptism doesn't save. You know. And what he's saying is essentially you can take the Bible and twist it to mean whatever you want. And that's what a lot of people do. But if you're going to preach the Bible as it's written, in the context that it's written, you're not going to come out with these falsified doctrines. And so here's the answer to this thing. I could take verse 18 and preach that all men are saved based on verse 18. I'd have to ignore verse 17, though. Look at what verse 17 says. For if by one man's offense, that's Adam, death reigned by one, which it did, much more they which receive. It's a choice. They which receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. You see, it's right there. The key to the gospel is you have to receive it. Okay? And you receive it by faith. Right? Yes, Jesus died for all men. That is a fact. But the other fact that you have to get is the payment is only applied to those who receive it. Okay? And you receive it by choosing to believe the gospel and putting your faith in Christ. Okay? So you might say the potential for salvation is available for every man, but it's not actual in that person's life until it's received. That's why free will is such a big deal. You have to receive the gospel. You have to believe it. You have to choose that. The payment that was made on Calvary does nothing for the person who won't receive it. Amen. Okay? As a matter of fact, it only condemns that person even more, because here God went out of his way to send his only begotten son to die on a cross for your sins so that you could be saved as a free gift, and you still reject it. That's the worst sin of all. I mean, that's the big one added to your pile of other iniquities. Listen, Jesus' payment was a full payment. It's so full and it's so complete that when you believe and get your sins forgiven, you also get the righteousness of God imputed to you. I mean, you are clearer than clear when you get saved. I mean, a Scientologist could only dream as being as clear as you are. I mean, your scarlet sins were made white as snow. You are forgiven with a capital F, you know, but you only get in on it if you believe. Look at Romans chapter 4. Romans chapter 4, verse 5. But to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness, right? Okay, so now this all makes sense in terms of legal justice, okay? It all makes sense in terms of legal justice. If you have a theology that doesn't fit legally with justice, then there's something off with your theology, all right? Calvinist is way off in their theology. All right, when it comes to Calvary, the whole thing is an exchange. God's righteousness for my sin, okay? And God won't force his righteousness upon someone who doesn't want it, right? That wouldn't be right for him to do so. You can't do, that's not right, right? He'd be violating their free will. And God won't forgive the sins of someone who doesn't want their sins forgiven. And God won't impute righteousness to someone who doesn't want it. He won't do it. God gives every man the choice, okay? Jesus has already made the payment, and he is ready and waiting to apply it to your account, but that is your choice. You can choose that. If you refuse that payment, you are in essence choosing to pay for your own sin. You are in essence, if you refuse the gospel, you are essentially saying, no thank you, Jesus. I will go ahead and deal with your Father myself. I am certain that my works are just as good as yours, and that your Father will be pleased with me and accept me for who I am. Do you really want to take that risk? How well do you think that's going to work out? For me, I decided to play it safe and take Jesus' payment for my sin. And if that's a crutch, then crutch me up. Amen. And, you know, nothing I've said so far is new to you. I'm sure you're all just about, you know, falling asleep. No, I'm just joking. You know everything I've said. We all believe this. We all know that to be true, okay? Nothing I've said is new. You've probably already understood that salvation has to be received, okay? We know that. The offender must go to the one he offended and ask for forgiveness before it's granted, right? Absolutely. And until that happens, the sinner is not forgiven, correct? Okay. So then why are Christians told that they have to forgive people when God himself has not forgiven those people? It's an interesting question. Do you really think that if someone murders your kids, that God requires you to forgive them when he himself hasn't even forgiven that person for murdering your children? Why would you have to forgive that person for murder when God hasn't even forgiven that person for murder? Do you understand? Why? That doesn't make any sense. Do you see how emotionally traumatic this could be for people who are forced to twist their own minds and hearts into forgiving someone when there is no basis for the forgiveness? People want to be right with God, understandably. If you have a right heart with God, you want to be right with God, right? And they're being forced to forgive people because they're told that if you don't forgive, you're a bad person and you're bitter. You know, and God won't forgive you. That's the kind of thing. And most of the time, deep down, they feel that I can't forgive. And the reason why is because there's no basis for the forgiveness. And then, but then they're tormented by a false sense of guilt for not being able to forgive. You know, what's wrong with me? I'm supposed to forgive this person who killed my kids, but I just can't forgive him. Here comes the condemnation, because you're bitter. You're unforgiving. Well, maybe the reason why you can't forgive that person is because there's nothing in heaven and earth that says you should. Maybe the reason why you're having such a hard time forgiving that person is because the God that fills heaven and earth has not forgiven that person for what they did. And that might have something to do with why you have a hard time forgiving that person. Because you're trying to do something that God himself hasn't even done. You see? Now I know what you're thinking. What about what Jesus said while on the cross? Okay, legitimate question. Turn to Luke chapter 23. Luke chapter 23. Christianity has to fit a line of justice. It has to conform to justice because God is a just judge. Everything about Calvary was according to the law. Everything about the life of Jesus Christ was in accordance with the law. He didn't come to break the law. He came to fulfill the law. Every single thing about what Jesus did was according to the book. By the book. It had to be. Otherwise, it would have been null and void. All right? So you have to be able to look at these subjects not on the basis of emotion, but on the basis of fact and truth and the law. Okay? That's how this works. All right? Leviticus chapter 23, verse 34. All right? Then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. All right? Now, certainly, there is some various impressions that we can at least get from this verse. Absolutely. Okay, let's think about it. But is the impression biblical, right? Or is it just a misinterpretation of Scripture? So we got to think about these things, all right? Here's some impressions that we could get from this verse, okay? When Jesus said this, he forgave everyone who ever lived and ever will live. You know, Jesus on the cross, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And it spans out through the expanse of time and space and eternity. And everybody who ever sinned was forgiven in that moment. Well, that goes back to that universal salvation concept where everyone is automatically saved because Jesus' death on the cross, which we know is not true. Okay? So that impression, you can get that impression, but it's not biblical. All right? Number two, here's another impression you could get. When Jesus said this, he was showing that we simply need to unconditionally forgive people, no matter what they do to us. And not forgiving people is wrong. All right, this is more the general belief on this thing. But hold on. As we've already seen, there are billions of lost people in the world right now who have their sin upon them and the wrath of God abides on them, according to John 3:36, right? Okay? And God himself is therefore harboring unforgiveness towards these people. Right? The average unsaved person you meet out there, they're not forgiven. So therefore, God is harboring unforgiveness. Okay? Or to make it plainer, Jesus is harboring unforgiveness for the lost soul out there right now. Now, question, do you think that God the Father is harboring unforgiveness, but God the Son isn't? Do you think God the Son and God the Father are up in heaven just constantly having this battle every day? You know, we go around and around and around in circles with this all the time. You know, you're all unforgiving, and I just want to forgive them. You know, and then Jesus is saying forgive them, and God the Father is saying no, don't forgive them. God the Father is wrathful, and Jesus is merciful. And then you got Mary, you know, trying to stick her head in there, trying to get her. No, well, of course not. You know, if your idea is that God the Father is vengeful and angry, but God the Son is forgiving and merciful, well, you've got a funky God there and something is messed up in your theology. Okay? There's zero discrepancy in the thinking of the God the Father and God the Son. And I know you know that. But how does that fit with the general interpretations that come from this passage? Okay? Why would Jesus harbor forgiveness on the cross but unforgiveness on the throne? You see? Like I said, you got to think a little bit. He said, Father, forgive them. Why is that not his attitude now? What changed? Why does he harbor forgiveness on the cross, but unforgiveness on the throne, evidently? Furthermore, how come at the second advent, Jesus' words are not forgive them, but rather destroy them? According to Deuteronomy 32:27. What changed? What's the deal? Right? How come Acts 17:30 talks about the heathen sinning in ignorance? Right? The times of this ignorance God winked at, right? They are sinning in ignorance, but Jesus doesn't say of the heathen, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. No. To the contrary, he commandeth all men everywhere to repent. Right? So what's up with that? Well, like I said, as usual, you're going to have to think. And that's what I'm trying to encourage you to do this morning. Is just think about it. Does that really work? Does that fit? What is Luke 23:34 talking about? And truthfully, Luke 23:34, Jesus' words on the cross are pivotal to your understanding of forgiveness. Because if your understanding of forgiveness is that, you know, obviously this is the worst thing that mankind could ever do to somebody. Crucify him, spit in his face, crown of thorns. It doesn't get worse than Calvary. And if Jesus could say, Father, forgive them, then what could possibly anybody do to you that you should not forgive them for unconditionally? Nobody asked for forgiveness here, right? No, they didn't. But Jesus said, Father, forgive them. So therefore, the mentality is, well, you need to forgive everybody for everything and everything, no matter what, because no matter what anybody does to you, it's not as bad as that, right? And so therefore, unconditional forgiveness no matter what. If you don't, you're not right with God. You just don't have the sweet spirit of Jesus. That's kind of the way it's preached, all right? Well, let's think about it. I personally believe, and you're free to disagree with me if you want, but I'm going to show you what I think and why I think it this morning. I think that I did some impromptu street preaching yesterday. And I kind of blew my lung out a little bit, and I was thinking, oh, I better stop. Unfortunately, I did. It was just real last minute, you know, but anyway, so sorry. I apologize for the squeaking. You know, I'm not, you know, that's just the way it goes. I believe that this verse in Luke 23:34 is usually interpreted wrong, truthfully. And as a consequence, most people's understanding of forgiveness and how it works and when it's required is also wrong. I'm just going to say that. It's really not that difficult, in my opinion, when it's read slowly and your preconceived notions are discarded and you simply believe what you're reading, okay? But you also have to study to show yourself approved because it's not, well, let me show you. Luke 23:32. Let's look at it. All right. Now, I'm not saying that I just think I'm smarter than everybody. It's not that. It's just when you think about these things, it's like the way it's generally presented doesn't seem to fit justice. And how does that work if God is a just judge? All right. So let's think about it. Verse 32, and there were also two other malefactors led with him to be put to death. And when they were come to the place, which is called Calvary, there they crucified him and the malefactors, one on the right hand and the other on the left. All right, they crucified him and the malefactors, one on the right hand and the other on the left. Then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. All right? So who is the they that crucified Jesus? Let's think about that. Whoever the they is, they are the ones that don't know what they are doing, and God, Jesus is asking his Father to forgive them. All right? Now, we could speculate as to exactly who the they are, but there's no need, because the next portion of the verse tells you exactly who the they are that Jesus is referring to. Look at it. Then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And they parted his raiment and cast lots. Oh, that's interesting. I wonder who parted his raiment and cast lots. Hold your finger there and look at John 19. John 19. John 19, verse 23. Then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garments and made four parts to every soldier a part, and also his coat. Now the coat was without seam, woven from the top throughout. They said therefore among themselves, let us not rend it, but cast lots for it, whose it shall be, that the scripture might be fulfilled, which saith, they parted my raiment among them, and for my vesture they did cast lots. These things, therefore, the soldiers did. You see how the Holy Spirit throws that last little piece in there? These things, therefore, the soldiers did. It's like the Holy Spirit's going out of his way to make sure you know exactly who it is that's parting his raiment. And for some reason, the Holy Spirit thinks it's important that you get that. It was these things the soldiers did. The reason why that detail is so important is because it was the Roman soldiers specifically that crucified Jesus Christ. It was the Roman soldiers specifically that parted his garment, and it was the Roman soldiers specifically that had no idea what they were doing. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do, and they parted his raiment and cast lots. Right? These Roman soldiers were just a bunch of young men who were given an order. Think about it. I'm guessing if they had any humanity left in them, they probably hated crucifixions. I mean, wouldn't you? I mean, think about it. They're bloody, they're messy, and the blood-curdling screaming and moaning would probably haunt any man for the rest of his life and give you nightmares. You know, it was probably one of the worst assignments that any soldier could ever be given. You know, and these soldiers probably cursed under their breath and considered themselves the unlucky you-know-whats that got stuck with crucifixion duty that day. I hate crucifixion duty. Why do I had to be the one on the shift today for this, you know? So early in the morning. You know, I mean, blankety blank, it's not even 9 in the blankety blank morning, and already I gotta go up that blankety blank hill and do a blankety blank crucifixion. You know, blankety blank, I haven't even had my blankety blank coffee yet. You know, they're soldiers. They're soldiers. That's how soldiers talk. That's how soldiers think. Every single word is a curse. And they didn't know who the guys were that were being crucified, and they didn't care. They just wanted to get it over with so they could go on with the rest of their day. They had to crucify, injure, and cause the death of the creator of the universe, the Son of God. But they themselves had no idea who it was, and they were not responsible for what they did there, for what was going on. They were not the ones that chose to crucify and reject Jesus Christ. They were following an order, and Jesus knew that. Jesus knew that. Now think about that. Jesus knew that. These were the men, the specific handful of individuals that caused him immense pain. These were the guys that did it. But Jesus knows that they're just following orders. So you know what Jesus said? Even though these men drove the nails into his hands and feet and chimed in with the other people that were mocking him, they didn't start it. These other guys were mocking him, and like soldiers, you know, yeah, blankety blank, you know, making fun of him. Jesus knew these young men had no idea what they were doing that day. And so in mercy, Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. In other words, Father, forgive these Roman soldiers, for they know not what they do. You see, the unconditional forgiveness of Jesus on the cross, I believe, was limited to a specific group of people. He didn't forgive everyone because not everyone there didn't know what they were doing. There were some people there that did know what they were doing. There were some people there who knew that Jesus was innocent. The Roman soldiers didn't get it until after he died. It was finally his last words on the cross. He says, Father, you know, they're probably watching this thing and thinking, after they had already nailed the guy, you can't get the crowbar and pull him off the cross once he's up there. But after they nailed him, this guy was not acting like all the other people that they'd crucified before. You know, here he's saying, Father, forgive them, you know, referring to the guy, to me, who had just put him on the cross. And he, forgive me? What? That was weird. You know, and then he's saying, you know, woman, behold thy son. And all these things are happening on the cross and this darkness. And then finally, you know, his very last words are, Father, into thy hand I commend my spirit. He's not cussing. He's not screaming. He's not doing all this stuff, you know, saying that, you know, cursing every single thing around like these other two thieves. It wasn't like that. You know, this one thief, you know, both of them are cursing him, and then finally one of them said, you know, repents and says, you know, I'll take me, you know, he says, what's his words? He said, basically, he repents, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom, right? And he says, he doesn't say blankety blank, are you kidding me? After what you just called me? No, it wasn't like that. He says, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. And the Roman soldiers are watching. It's like, man, I've never seen a crucifixion like this before. And then Father, finally, his last words are, Father, into thy hand I commend my spirit. He cries out, you know, and that's the end. And then they say, truly, this was the Son of God. They didn't get it when they were nailing him to the cross. They just thought he was some other Joe Blow. They didn't get it until afterwards. They had no idea what they were doing. But there were some people who had a pretty good idea of what they were doing. There were some people who knew he was innocent. They knew he was sent from God. They knew that he claimed to be the Son of God. They knew that he claimed to be the Christ. And they were not ignorant. Let me show you the scriptures so you know that I'm not just making this up. Turn to John chapter 7. We'll flip to a bunch of verses real fast. John chapter 7. Now, I know that this is way different than the way it's normally preached. I'm not worried about disagreeing with the majority on this thing. I'm just trying to preach the book as I believe it's written here, regardless of whether I'm going against the grain or not. I believe this is what the scripture says, and this actually fits God's legal standard of justice. All right, John 7:28. Then Jesus cried in the temple. So he's speaking to Jews as he taught, saying, "Ye both know me. Ye know me, and ye know whence I am." Do you think Jesus was mistaken when he said that?
No.
He says, "I'm not come of myself, but he that sent me is true, and whom ye know not." Look at chapter 10, John chapter 10. John chapter 10, verse 23. Jesus walked in the temple in Solomon's porch. Okay, we're dealing with Jews again. Verse 24, then came the Jews round about him and said unto him, "How long dost thou make us to doubt? If thou be the Christ, tell us plainly." Jesus answered them, "I told you. I've already told you." The problem isn't ignorance. The problem is faithlessness. They've chosen not to believe. "I told you, and ye believe not. The works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me." Look at Luke 22. Luke 22. What I'm getting at is this isn't just my interpretation. You've got this all throughout the New Testament. And so these verses need to be reconciled with Luke 23. Okay? There's no contradiction in the Bible. But when you find an apparent contradiction, you have to figure out, okay, well, what is going on here? Luke 22, verse 66. "And as soon as it was day, the elders of the people and the chief priests and the scribes came together and led him into their council, saying," okay, we got Jews again, "Art thou the Christ? Tell us. And he said unto them, If I tell you, you will not believe." Why? Because I've already told you and you didn't believe. Nothing's going to change, right? And he says, "And if I ask you, you're not going to answer me. You will not answer me, nor let me go. Hereafter ye shall see the Son of Man sit on the right hand of the power of God. Then said they all, Art thou the Son of God? And he said unto them, Ye say that I am." In other words, that's the old colloquial for, "You said it, bud. You got it." And there was no confusion as to what Jesus said here, because look at what they say in verse 71. "And they said, What need we any further witness? For we ourselves have heard of his own mouth." Heard what? That he believes he is the Son of God, the Christ. Right? They understood. They were not ignorant. They just didn't believe. Okay? Mark chapter 12, Jesus gives a parable, a turn there, Mark chapter 12, about a man who planted a vineyard and set up his husbandmen to tend to it. And after a while, you know, he sends his servants to the vineyard to see how things are going. And the husbandmen would keep beating up and killing his servants. And finally, the man said, "Well, I know, I'll send my son and maybe they'll reverence my son." But to the contrary, it says, those husbandmen said among themselves, Mark 12, verse 7, those husbandmen said among themselves, "This is the heir." They know who he is. "Come and let us kill him, and the inheritance shall be ours." And they took him and killed him and cast him out of the vineyard. "What shall therefore the Lord of the vineyard do? He will come and destroy the husbandmen and will give the vineyard unto others." Look at verse 12. "And they," the Pharisees, "sought to lay hold on him, but feared the people." Why? "For they knew that he had spoken the parable against them." They knew they were the husbandmen. They knew he was the heir. See it? All right? "And they left him and went their way." So the husbandmen did know what they were doing. Okay? They knew who the heir was and they killed him. The Pharisees did know to a certain extent that Jesus was the heir. They simply didn't want to believe it, so their refusal to believe resulted in their blindness. But ignorance wasn't the problem. Unbelief was the problem. Turn to John chapter 3. I'll show you one more. John chapter 3. John chapter 3, verse 1. "There came a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews, and the same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God. For no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him. They knew. To some extent, they were not the ones that knew not what they do. They knew what they were doing. So like I said, I know this goes against the grain of what most of us have heard all of our life, but I don't believe that Jesus forgave everyone on the cross. There's one verse in Acts 3 that might make you think otherwise, you know, and you could argue it, but I believe that could be answered by Luke 24:20 if you want to study that out on your own. So Jesus forgave the Roman soldiers, I believe, not the Jews. You say, really? He didn't forgive the Jews? No, because here's, think about it. If Jesus forgave the Jews for crucifying him, there's really no significance to the people saying, his blood be upon us and upon our children, right? We point to that verse as an explanation for the supernatural hatred of the Jews over the last 2,000 years and, you know, the reason for the Holocaust and the horrors of Nazi Germany. But if Jesus forgave the Jews, okay, then that sin of crucifying Jesus would be cleared and they wouldn't be punished for it for the last 2,000 years. You see that? That's a problem. If you say that Jesus saying, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do, and so therefore he forgave the sins of the Jews for crucifying him, well, then you can't make an argument for Father, his blood be on us and our children. It's obsolete. It was forgiven. It's done. It's cleared. Forget about it. What are you going to do? You can't have both. Look at Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2. We're almost done. Acts chapter 2. I have to take a little bit of extra time with this subject because, like I said, I'm going out on a limb here that is different than the way it's usually presented. And so I can't just, you know, gloss over this. I have to show you the scriptures, okay? Acts chapter 2, verse 22. All right, Peter's preaching. Ye men of Israel, all right, Jews, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs which God did by him in the midst of you, as ye yourselves also know, him being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God, ye have taken and by wicked hands, Pilate's hands, have crucified and slain. Look at verse 36. Okay. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made that same Jesus whom ye have crucified, both Lord and Christ. Ah, oh, come on, Peter. Would you quit bringing that up? You know, you keep bringing up that we crucified Jesus. Jesus already forgave us for that. Didn't you hear what he said on the cross? Why do you keep up bringing up something that's already been forgiven? Right? All right? I mean, that's what you think. That's not what they said, but that would be a legitimate response if they were already forgiven. Well, if it's forgiven, then as far as God, the Almighty God's concerned, the slate's been wiped clean. Quit bringing it up. Quit preaching to me about crucifying Jesus. We're forgiven for that. Right? You got to think about it. Verse 37. Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, Men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, Don't worry about it. You're already forgiven because Jesus forgave you while he was on the cross. No. That's not what he said. If the Jews were forgiven, then why does Paul say in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2:16 that God's wrath is come upon them, the Jews, to the uttermost, all across the earth? Wherever they are, scattered across the earth, God's wrath has come upon them. And we've seen that throughout the last 2,000 years of history. They are persecuted every single place they go. Even today, you watch the news, 4,000 rockets shot by Gaza into Israel. They had the United Nations Security Assembly get together, I guess, recently, and they didn't say one word about Hamas shooting rockets into Israel. What's with all the anti-Semitism? Because they asked for it. They said, His blood be on us and on our children, and that is not going to be cleansed and cleared and their iniquity taken away until the millennium when Jesus comes back and gives them a new heart. and a new spirit and takes away their sins and their iniquities. You see? If they're forgiven already, if Jesus forgave everybody on the cross, okay, then why does God prophesy through Hosea and say, I will go down to the earth and return to my place up in heaven till they acknowledge their offense? There's a specific offense that God wants them to acknowledge. Not offenses. There's one offense that really has God upset that the Jews did. And he says, I'm going to return to my place till they acknowledge their offense. That's the crucifixion. And seek my face in their affliction, the tribulation. They will seek me early. If the Jews are forgiven, then why is Jesus still holding out and waiting for them to acknowledge what they did? You don't do that when you forgive someone. You don't hold it against them. If you forgive someone, it's forgiven. That's it. It's over. You drop it. You don't bring it up again. That's not what Jesus is doing. So do we have double jeopardy here or what? I forgive you, but actually, no, you're not forgiven. I just said you're forgiven, but you're really not forgiven. Is that how that works? No. He's still got a beef with Israel, and he hasn't dropped the issue. After 2,000 years, wow. You won't drop it. 2,000 years, you're still holding on to that. Yes. Yes. He hasn't dropped it. Well, time heals all wounds. Are you sure about that? The judge of the earth has to do right. There was a sin committed against him, and that has to be dealt with. And he has not forgiven those Jews. Okay? Listen, is that how Jesus is with you after he forgave you? Does God's wrath still abide on you for your sin? I mean, the idea is if Jesus forgave everyone on the cross and the Jews are forgiven, then why is God's wrath still on them? If they're forgiven, how does that work? And when you get forgiven, God's wrath is gone because your sins are gone. When it comes to forgiveness, the person who sinned is forgiven, and the forgiver is not to keep bringing it up and continually punishing the one who was forgiven. Otherwise, it's not true forgiveness. And I'll explain a little bit more of that next week. The only other thing you could say is when Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do, God didn't answer that prayer. And I don't believe that either. Jesus always got his prayers answered. All right? So I know it sounds nice to say that Jesus forgave everyone unconditionally on the cross, but that creates all kinds of contradictions in the Bible, and it just simply isn't true. It's not going to work. I'm sorry. And this teaching, okay, what I'm explaining to you to this morning, it doesn't lessen the greatness of Jesus, okay? You can have Jesus only forgiving the Roman soldiers and his love still be deeper than the deepest sea. You can have Jesus only forgiving the Roman soldiers and his first forgiveness still be vast beyond all measure. I mean, that's amazing that he would do that. None of that changes. But if you make it unconditional forgiveness for everyone, then it does imply that you too, as a Christian, should always give unconditional forgiveness no matter what. And that is not biblical. And I will show you that from the Bible next week. And as I told you, these lessons, that you're going to hear some things you've probably never heard before. This morning might be one of those mornings, okay? And I hope you learned something today, or at least, at the very least, have something to think about. You know, just think about it. Prove all things. Hold fast that which is good. Don't take my word for it. Study the Bible for yourself and see if what I'm saying is so. Because just because that's the way we've always done it, and that's the way it's always been taught, doesn't automatically make a thing correct. Okay? It might be time to go back to the drawing board. And on this particular subject of forgiveness, I am going back to the drawing board on this one. All right? So this will be a good opportunity for you to just, okay, let's hear it. Let's consider it. Let's not make any decisions right away. Let's just kind of be neutral and think about it. Think about it. All right? So this will be a good thing for you to ponder this next week. Study your Bibles. Get out your concordance. Look up the word forgiveness. See what the Bible says about it. And let's go close in a word of prayer. Father, I come before you today, and I thank you, God, for your word. And Lord, I honestly thank you so much, God, for what you did on the cross. Lord, it's just incredible, God, that you would even die and pay for my sins, knowing that I could full well reject the payment. But Father, you still sent your son to die for me anyway. Even God, if it was vain on my behalf, Father, Lord, you still, or could have been, Lord, if I hadn't received it. Father, Lord, you still did it anyway, because that's how much you cared about me, God. You had compassion for my soul. Thank you, God, for that, and thank you for your mercy. We appreciate it. Thank you for the love that's in Jesus Christ, and God, what a wonderful love it is to be loved by the God of the universe. And Father, we're just so thankful to be Christians. Honestly, Lord, this subject today I know is different than the way it's normally presented, but Father, there's a lot of ramifications that come from a misunderstanding of this particular subject, and God, it has a trickle-down effect that begins to really be noticed towards the end of those trickles. And so, Father, we got to go back to the beginning and the basics and figure out where we got off track with this thing. And I just pray that these things would be understood by your people, and that your Holy Spirit would give them light throughout the rest of the week. And God, we're not encouraging to be bitter, unforgiving, vengeful people, by no means, Father, by no means. But Father, we have to understand the legal technicalities of how forgiveness works so that we can make sure to teach it right and perform it right. And God, I just pray you'd help your people in these things. In Jesus' name, amen.